The following podcast is created and sponsored by High Beam Ministry.
Many people that I talk to believe, they actually believe that people can't change. They believe that once a person's personality is set, once they've done some things in their life, they're always going to be that kind of a person. And that is not true. However, it can be true if the person that is supposed to be doing the changing really doesn't want to change.
Aristotle noted, "Knowing yourself is the beginning of all wisdom." Today we have unprecedented insight into our personality and behavior. But what if you don't like what you see? Then the question is,
can people change their personalities?
Well, of course, a lot of people want to believe that anything is possible. So the concept of personality is a little bit alien because people are afraid it puts them in a box. And it says, you know, you can only do certain things.
This is, there's not a black or white. It's multidimensional.
Don't give up hope. Some people change against all odds, against the grain. Love finds a way. Some people change.
I'm going to say two words to you right now. I want you to listen to them very, very carefully. Then I want you to take them out of the office with you and incorporate them into your life.
Well, shall I write them down?
Well, if it makes you comfortable, it's just two words. Most people can remember them.
Okay.
You ready?
Yes.
Okay, here they are.
Stop it!
Welcome to the Ersatz Coffee Shop. This is Jay, your Truth Barista, and I'm serving up a steamy cup of God's truth for the average Joe. You can catch me and this podcast on my websites, truthbarista.com, all one word, truthbarista.com, and highbeamministry.com. That's HIGHBEAM ministry.com, as in car high beam. We're shining the light of God's truth on the road ahead. Hey, Larry.
Yeah.
Got some great jokes for you today.
Jokes?
No, really, really.
Wow.
Well, you know me. I'm not just the truth barista, but I'm also the joke barista, too.
Oh, boy.
Okay, you ready for this one?
I guess.
Okay, how many Lutherans does it take to change a light bulb?
How many Lutherans? Wow, you know, I really don't know.
Change?
Oh.
Okay, and I got another one for you. Okay, how many Pentecostals does it take to change a light bulb?
Oh, I don't know. They all have their arms in the air.
Yeah, they're already kind of prepositioned. You only need two, right? One to change the light bulb, and one to cast out the spirit of darkness. Like that one? Huh? Okay,
oh,
got one more
boy.
For you. Okay,
your email again is
thetruthbarista@gmail.com.
Yes.
Come on, we're just having fun here, folks. Okay, anyway, do you know how many psychologists it takes to change a light bulb?
Wow. Now that's good. I don't know. One's on the couch, I know, but I don't know.
No. It just takes one. But the light bulb has to really want to change.
Oh.
See? Good. Good dad jokes there, right?
Boy, I don't know. Boy, talk about change.
Yeah.
I mean, going beyond changing light bulbs into more of the dynamic of changing things in our lives.
Yeah.
Well, Matt came in again. Remember I told you about Matt before?
Yeah. The guy that's struggling with the whole pornography.
Yeah. He comes in here all the time, and he always throws some big words at you and all that. But he complains a lot about what he's doing inside, and I don't know what to tell him.
Okay.
I don't know what to say to him because he just seems, no matter what therapy, no matter what kind of advice he takes and counsel he gets, it doesn't help him.
That's not unusual. I mean, you know this. You've got things in your life that you need to change. I have things in my life that I want to change. I mean, having a coffee shop is almost like having a bar. You know, it's a coffee bar. People come in, and what do? They sit at the counter here, and they sit in the booths, and they pull us aside, and they tell us all the things they're struggling with.
Yeah.
And I think that's one of the biggest things I encounter with Christians and people in general, is this struggle with changing things in their lives. I mean, haven't you heard that? I mean, it's the same tune, just variations, right?
Right. And, you know, the psychology organizations, you know, the psychiatrists, they always talk about that change can never happen unless you really, really want it to happen. And, you know, I guess that's in general probably true, but it just kind of leaves a lot of people empty.
Right.
And trapped because they can't seem to get the willpower or whatever it is. They may even know how to change.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they may want to lose 50 pounds and they know how to do that. They just can't.
You know, I I was thinking about that too, because I have struggled with my weight all my life. But you know something? In the last year, I have lost 20 pounds.
Good for you.
Because I got to the point, every time I look in the mirror, I instinctively sucked in my gut. I kid you not. And I happened to be walking along one day, and I walked past a mirror, and I took that little side glance. It was like, holy smokes!
Yeah.
And I realized I caught a real glimpse of myself, and I said, something has to change here. And that really motivated me in this whole thing. But you know something? I think it takes a lot more than just personal strength for many people to change, because change is not something that's an outward thing. Change is primarily an inward thing, don't you think?
Well, I do. I do think change is inward. But how do you get that inward change to generate? How do you get it to take hold?
Okay.
Because a lot of people think they know how to change, but they just don't get it done.
Okay. Well, let's talk about this, because I was just going through the Bible today and I came across a wonderful scripture on change. And it comes from 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 11. You can look it up on your phone there.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. This is what Paul says. And he's writing to the Corinthian church, which, by the way, is a moral cesspool.
Mm-hmm.
And there's people struggling with all sorts of garbage in mm-hmm. their lives there. And Paul says something interesting. But first, he describes the garbage that they're in. He says, do you not know that the unrighteous, these are people that aren't slime dogs, is what he's talking about. These are people who are not living the way God wants them to, right?
Mm-hmm.
The unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. What does it mean to be, what's he talking about?
Unrighteous.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now he talks about the hallmarks of what is unrighteous. He says, don't be deceived. Neither fornicators, which is a fancy word for people who have sex outside of marriage, idolaters, or people who follow other gods, adulterers, we all know what that is, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites. Now, to be a little bit delicate, Paul is talking about men who are the givers and the receivers in the sex act. That's what those two words mean, okay? Nor thieves, we know what thieves are, nor covetousness. Those are people who covet or want other people's stuff.
Greedy. Mm-hmm.
Drunkards, revilers, those who revile other people and other things, and, or extortioners.
Mm.
I mean, that's quite a list, right?
Are those politicians?
Yeah, those are, yeah. Okay. No politician is going to make it. Just kidding. Listen to Christians in Politics message
there you
going
go.
Back. Okay. We'll inherit the kingdom of God. But this is the part that jumped out at me. And such were some of you. Now, you go back and you look at that list. There were fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, homosexuals, sodomites, thieves, covetous, drunkards, revilers, and extortioners in the Corinthian church. And Paul says, and such were some of you.
So,
which means there are some who are still struggling with this.
Right. But some that it says to me specifically that you can change.
And there were some that did change. Now, this is funny because think about our culture today. What are some people saying? Well, you know, homosexuals are born that way.
You can't change.
Gays are born that mm-hmm. way. You can't change. Okay. Well, you know, I got to sleep with my girlfriend because we love each other and the feelings are so strong.
We can't change.
You know, I can't help but covet what so-and-so has. I mean, it's coveting is not a big deal, is it? You know, I'm addicted. I can't change. Change from being a drunk or a drug addict. I can't change. But this is not what God is saying here. God is saying, and such were some of you. So there's a hope there that if you want to change, it is possible to change. But the question that you had is, how do we change? Isn't it?
Right. And I think some of this has to do with feelings. People just don't feel like they can change, or their feelings deceive them or betray them, and therefore they don't think there is any way that they can change. But this verse says that they can.
Exactly. And we have to remember, feelings do not define us. Okay, feelings do not define us. It's a popular thing right now, the whole transgender thing. I may feel like a woman, but it doesn't change my DNA. A woman may feel like a man, doesn't change the DNA. You can't put something as shifting and as transitory as feelings over facts. You have to align the feelings to the facts, not the facts to the feelings. That is a major deception in our culture today.
And I think that feelings were not designed to be necessarily change agents. They could be, but I don't think they have the power. So the question I always have is, if you're going to change and there's going to be transformation, what is it in the power of whatever that is to make that transformation happen? Isn't there some
yep.
kind of definition you can give for that kind of power?
Yep. In fact, you can find the source of it. And me being the truth barista, you have to go continue what Paul is writing. And such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, and you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of God. So let's talk about that. What does it mean to have a transformed life? And what do those three words mean? Okay, so what's a transformed life? Basically means the construction of that whole word, and you know me, I also love words, right?
Mm-hmm.
Trans means across, and form means to create or a structure. What you're doing is you're altering something radically in form, in its function, or its nature. Okay, when you're talking at a radical level, that word radical means root. It doesn't mean somebody who's a wild-haired, crazy person, okay? Radical, as a word, means root. So when you're transforming, when you go through a radical transformation, you're talking about a person who has been altered at the very root of who they are. That's a radical transformation. They're changed from one form to another. You following me so far?
I am following you. I have some questions, but I am following you.
Okay, so the root level of our life is not our feelings. It's not our mind, will, and emotion. The root level of our life is our spirit. That's the spirit that works with who we are, our life force, our soul, if you want to call it that. That's the inside of who we are. Because if that leaves our body, that's it.
So when we talk about the heart, is the heart the same as the spirit, or is it similar? Because Jeremiah said this, when this is the question I had, he said that the heart is wicked, and some versions say that it's beyond cure.
Right. And according to the Hebrew way of thinking about scripture, the heart can be feelings, the heart can be your thinking. Takes place in the heart. And so our feelings and our thinking can be very deceptive and
right.
lead us into all sorts of wrong areas.
Yes.
Or it can contradict the facts of what God says about it. Well, I feel like a sinner even though Jesus saved me. Well, you're not a sinner in that sense. You may sin, but Jesus has forgiven you as a sinner. Okay, you see the
that
difference
makes
there?
Sense. Sure. Yes,
okay,
absolutely.
So what we're trying to get to is the heart of the matter here. And once you get to the heart of the matter, the core of the matter, that's where change takes place. And so he says, you were washed, sanctified, and justified. So, Larry, look at your Bible on verse 11.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Jesus saved you and transformed you. Okay. This is what Romans says. Knowing this, that our old man, now when he says old man, he's talking about who we used to be, our nature inside. Our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. When we are born, we're born with a nature that loves to run away from God and rebel against God. Jesus comes in and God says, the only way that we're going to have to deal with this is we're going to have to destroy that old nature and rebuild it spiritually. I know your house, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Your house is a beautiful old house. How long did it take you to renovate it?
30 years.
Okay. God's not talking about a 30-year renovation and he's not talking about remodeling. He's talking about a complete teardown. So when God comes into our lives through Jesus, his spiritual work is to destroy that old nature that is a slave to rebellion against God. It just wants to do it, just has to do it, right? And he changes us at that radical level.
Okay? That's very good.
So when he pulls out the root, what is he replacing it with? He says you get a new nature, a new spiritual nature, which is free from sin. Before, I have the impulse and the drive to rebel against God. After the new nature change, what do I have? Now I have the freedom to obey that desire or not. That's a fundamental change in Christians.
So say, for example, let's use that illustration. You tear down an old house to rebuild it. At that point, you have God's nature, his spirit within you. But where does discipleship fit into all of that? Because, you know, it's what God does for us and then what we do for him through his word and his spirit, right? I mean, isn't discipleship wanting to make changes in us?
Right. Let me give you another illustration. I'll go right into that one. Think about this. We all know computers, right? Okay, let's think of it in these terms. We're all computer heads. We're all computer geeks. We get this, right? What happens if you have a fundamental failure in your laptop or your computer? You replace the motherboard, right? That's the hardware. But the hardware needs something to run. That's the software. So think of it in this way. We are built, actually, we come into this world because of sin with a faulty BIOS, with faulty hardware. So God takes out that board and replaces it now with a father board. And then he downloads a new operating system within us. And then from that operating system, we have to upload or download or inload the software. Let me tell you in Bible terms. God says in the new covenant, I will take out your heart of stone, which is an unrepentant heart, which is a heart that resists him. I'll give you a heart of flesh, which is a responsive heart that wants to follow his ways. There's the board replacement. He says, I will write my laws upon your heart. There's the bios, and I will put my spirit in you and cause you to walk according to my ways. That's what's going to help us now run the software. What's the software? His word. You put all of those things together, and that's what fundamentally changes a person's life. You need that replacement on the inside, and then our job is to download the software, which is the Bible and God's truth, put it together with the Holy Spirit's work, and we cooperate with him. Cooperate.
Oh, I love that. That's a great...
Does that make sense?
Oh, it makes a whole lot of sense. But let's come back to Matt. Matt says he's a Christian, but he's struggling with this pornography and everything. Is that a virus?
Okay, well, and you could maybe talk about a bug in the system.
Okay.
Okay. And what do you do with a bug in the system? You got to chase it down. Now, the first thing, you know, Larry, I really feel for Matt because I know the struggles of life. I know there are things that people, as Christians, will struggle with for the rest of their lives. I mean, there's guys out there that I talk to who are, you know, 80s and 90s, and they go, oh yeah, I still struggle with the lust thing. You know, it's like, really? That doesn't go away? And they go, no, it doesn't, because there are things. Look at Paul's list. It is not just lust. It's a whole bunch of things. You know, how many people struggle with wanting other people's stuff?
All the time.
I would love to have his wife. I'd love to have her husband. You know, I'd love to do this, and I really want this.
I really would like his jet ski.
Yeah, exactly. I'd like his job. I mean, how much of this propels us? Even John talks about it. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. These are things that appeal to our flesh, that appeal to our soul, and things that feed our pride. We all struggle with these things, but God says, yeah, I get it, but don't define yourself by that. You are a new creation. Why? Jesus has replaced the interior, the nature, the motherboard with a fatherboard, so to speak. And now, with the Holy Spirit's work, we are now moving forward and being changed, okay? Let me add this here, too. Colossians 1 says, Larry, he has rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son he loves. We're not talking about having a foot in two worlds here. He says you're either in one or you're in the other. Mm. It's like me hopping on a jet in New York and going to Jerusalem. I'm in an entirely different location and I'm under a whole different set of laws in Israel than I am in New York. Okay, now, what about Matt? He's a Christian. He's been changed on the inside, but I still struggle with the feelings. I get it, but God says you are not to be conformed to your feelings. Scripture says you're being made into the image of Jesus. Jesus is not to be made into the image of you. So, yeah, I'm a Christian. That means I need to funnel my feelings and channel my feelings into and not let them override my actions. You get it?
Oh, I do. And what you're saying, you're like a computer doctor for somebody like Matt, that you're coming in and identifying that particular virus and helping, like you are today, and explaining how we can overcome the things that keep crashing our system, more or less.
Let's go back to that list. Okay, do you remember when Paul's talking about that list? If you look at everything on that list, every one of those things, fornication, idolatry, adultery, homosexual, sodomite, thieves, covetous, except for covetousness, everything is in action, which is significant, because one of the things that God wants us to do is he's going, stop acting ungodly, now be godly. That's what repentance is. I'm going to stop living the world's way in an ungodly way, and now I'm going to turn 180 degrees, and I'm going to live God's way. And then, during this process, I'm going to channel my thoughts and my feelings to align with what God wants. So, the core is the inner thing. Okay, that's the new nature. The Holy Spirit now helps me take my feelings and my thoughts and align them with my inner nature. And then I cooperate by taking all my outward actions and coordinating them and aligning them with my inner nature. I stop doing the things I'm not supposed to do, and I'm doing the things I'm supposed to do. Does that make sense?
It makes a whole lot of sense. But how does repentance then, how is it different than remorse? Because a lot of people think repentance is, I'm feeling bad, I got caught at something, or I did something wrong,
and
I feel,
and Matt, you know. I mean, Matt, exactly. Oh, I did it again.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
There's a difference between remorse and repentance. Remorse is feeling bad about what you did, but it doesn't lead to any change. Remorse is kind of like self-punishment, okay? We talked to Carrie, remember? She feels bad about certain things, so how did she punish herself? In her remorse, it involved self-punishment, cutting.
That's right.
Okay? Now, if you're really repentant is a change of action. And what happens is now the thoughts and the feelings are caught between what you feel on the inside and then your actions on the outside. So what you're doing is, in a sense, you are willfully dragging your thoughts and your feelings to align with what God wants. Is that pleasant? No, it's not. It can be a real struggle. And that's why it's great to hang around a bunch of Christians who are struggling as well, because they can be a real encouragement to you. They can be a real support. And you know something? Don't sell prayer short either. By praying, by spending time with God, it's amazing what God can do to transform a life as far as your thoughts and your feelings go.
And you're sort of describing that verse out of Philippians, work out your salvation with fear and trembling, because you do that not only within yourself, but you do that, obviously, others are helping you to become more like Christ, or, you know, help you get the bugs out.
Yeah, the modern day church cannot say, well, Jesus has saved you, and thank God you're good, and, you know, be warned. And be fed kind of thing. We have to work out. When Paul says, work out your salvation, he's going, you've been saved. Now get to work cooperating with the Holy Spirit so that you can become more like Jesus. He is the model. He is the goal. We shouldn't be settling for anything less. And he gives us everything we need, a freed up nature, free from being compulsive with sin. And number two, he gives us the Holy Spirit to deal with, to wrestle with those thoughts and emotions that trip us up. Now, the thing is how do we deal with people who are struggling, who aren't saved? How do we deal with people who are struggling in sin? Jesus is the perfect example. He went to Levi, who was an IRS agent, okay? In those days, he was a tax collector.
Mm-hmm.
People hated tax collectors because they often took a little bit more than they were charged. They charged their own sliding scale of fees, and they were Roman collaborators in the Jews' eyes. So what does Jesus do? He looks at this IRS agent, and he says, follow me. He's a rabbi telling this guy to give up this profession and now follow him. When you followed a rabbi, the point is to learn and to do, to become exactly like the rabbi.
Very good.
He is calling Matthew to repent of his old lifestyle and follow him in a new one. Okay, there's a picture of somebody who's saved. Do you think Matthew was made perfect right there, or Levi was made perfect? The same name for the, two names for the same guy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Do you think Levi was made perfect? No.
No.
But he started the process. So Jesus does what? He has dinner with him. Oh, and a bunch of Levi's friends show up, bunch of other tax collectors and ne'er-do-wells, right? And they have a party. Jesus is having dinner with sinners. So what should we do who are in process with Jesus? We don't forsake those who are struggling, and we shouldn't forsake those who have never even met Jesus. We should be having dinner with sinners with the purpose of all bringing people forward. Jesus did not go to have dinner with sinners and let them sit and be who they are. Jesus is the change agent. He went there to see people changed, and he hung with the people who were changed to see the change continue. That's discipleship.
You know, I had a friend once that was a pastor, an associate pastor in a church, and he also worked for a Christian organization. And he got up one day and he said, you know, I have no one to witness to because everybody in my life is a Christian at work and at church is where he spent most of his time. And so, you know, this is so contrasting that because Jesus was right in the middle of the local bar.
Yeah.
If you want to put it in modern day terminology.
It's like I had once heard a pastor say, you know, the Pharisees were saying to Jesus when he was having dinner with sinners, Jesus, we want you to set the bar. We don't want you to join a minute.
Yeah.
Okay, now you can go into those settings and still be a solid witness for God. You don't go to a bar with a bunch of sinners and get drunk.
Right.
That's not the point. You go to be with the sinners in order to bring God's light to them, to be an example to them, to be a loving help to them, because eventually, at some point, somebody's going to say, what have you got that I need right now? I see it. I need to find freedom from this compulsion to do this.
Right.
I need help in some way. And you can say, this is my story. This is my song. No, anyway, this is my story. I was once like you. I had a compulsive desire to do this. But when Jesus came into my life, he changed me in the inside, and I didn't have that compulsion anymore. And by the way, Larry, I am telling you for real what has happened in my life. I had these compulsions and things that I followed in high school and in college that were really difficult to overcome. But there came a point when Jesus said, okay, you're a Christian, now we're going to get to work on this. And through his word and the guiding of the Holy Spirit, putting thoughts into my head and how to do some things and to do a fast and whatever, he broke the compulsions in my life. And they haven't come back in 30-something years.
Wow. Well, I do think the greatest witness we have is a transformed life. We act different, we talk different, we assess things different, and people notice that. Even though at times we may get flack for that, people still notice that there's something different about a transformed life, and that's really what we need to be. Not trying to be relevant and fit in necessarily and be like them. We need to be with them, but not of them.
That's the mistake of the Western Church and a lot of U.S. churches. Sad to say, they want to, in their quest to be relevant, they're having dinner with sinners without expecting Jesus to change them. The real thing is not relevant, it's repentance. Mm-hmm. You go to have dinner with sinners to see Jesus reach them and bring the change process, to start the change process, to continue the change process. And by the way, Scripture says that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. When Jesus comes back, whether you are raised from the dead or you are raptured to meet him in the air or whatever, at that point, you will find the change completed in you. Your mind, your will, your emotions, your everything will be aligned exactly as God wants it to be. That's what's coming. In the meantime, we struggle. And that's why we have to encourage each other. We have to learn his word. You have to give something the Holy Spirit to burn in your life. And that's his word, to ignite the word to help you change. Otherwise, you can just be a changed but cold, dead Christian.
Our goal then, if you could summarize all of this up and become more transformed, is that we're supposed to be looking not like more like ourselves, but more like him.
Right. We shouldn't settle to look like the world.
Yes, that's correct.
We're not to settle. Jesus says we are to look like him.
And we're to have more or less, more than less, his opinions, not my opinions. What good is my opinions in anything, really, right?
It means nothing. We have our opinions.
It means nothing.
What's more important is his fact.
There you go.
Okay, his word is his spiritual fact. We make our feelings and our thoughts line up with his fact. I may feel like I'm this, but that's my opinion. The Lord says, no, you have been what? You have been washed. In other words, you've been changed inside. You've been sanctified. You're set apart for the Lord and you're beginning to act like him. And you've been justified. That word justified, a lot of pastors say, it's just as if I'd never sinned. No, that's not the full meaning of the word. The full meaning is when you're justified, you did commit those sins. But in God's eyes, that's old news. That's done with. I am brand new and justified in his eyes. I'm made right in his eyes.
Well, you've been very helpful, and I think the next time Matt comes in, I'm going to lay some of this stuff on him.
We'll keep praying for him, and you know, if you see him, give me a call or whatever. I'll be right over, and maybe we can sit down and really help him.
Thank you for joining us today. In today's world, we need to know more about life than what we are fed through our normal channels of communication. Even in many of our churches, we are not hearing the whole truth about God and his word. Pastors today are often afraid to address the themes and culture that might get them to be targeted by the cancel culture. Congregations are divided on the issues, and it makes a pastor's job more difficult to address those spiritual areas that might divide the church. This was one of the reasons the Truth Barista came into existence. We wanted to provide a message without any strings attached or be subjected to division in the church. We want to bring you a strong biblical message that doesn't come with limitations or restrictions on what can be said. No one wants to have information withheld from them, right? We all want to know the truth. The Truth Barista is a podcast that brings you truth based on God's Word, the Bible. We hope that you'll become a regular listener and be informed on the truth concerning the issues of our day. Join the RSS family by providing your email address on our website, and you'll be sent a link every time a new podcast comes out. Our website is highbeamministry.com. That's highbeamministry.com.
This is Jay, your Truth Barista. Thanks for listening to the Truth Barista podcast. The best way to find out when a new podcast drops is through RSS feed. Go to our website, look for the RSS button, press it, and then enter your email. You'll be notified when a new podcast drops. Thanks for listening.